Podium? Nope. Peace out.
Good evening, everybody. Let's give God a hand clap of praise tonight. We still have a lot of folks that are out on vacation, that are out of town. We have a lot of folks that had to work late, different things going on. We'll have some folks that will still be coming in. But most importantly, the Lord is here tonight. Amen. How many of you came expecting God to move in a miraculous way tonight? Even though we're here on Wednesday night and you know, it's feeling like we're trying to get back to some normalcy, you came on the right night, I can promise you that. And we want to do a couple of things that we normally do. If we have any visitors tonight, or if it's been a while since you've been here, I'm not trying to embarrass anybody, you guys know what the drill is. We just want to ask you to stand up. You don't have to say anything. Just stand up where you are, visiting with us. And church, let's make Isaiah welcome. Come on. Come on. Make some real noise. You can do that tonight. Make him feel like he wants to be here. Come on. Damn. Come on, make some noise, boy. We're glad to have you, though. And as I said, this is a wonderful, wonderful night for you to be here. And we appreciate those that are still coming in. I've got an exciting word from the Lord. But we're going to give you an opportunity to walk around and give virtual hugs and virtual handshakes. And Brother Barry's going to give us some music as the praise team comes on up and we get ready. Thank you. Wednesday night goes to our young people, and for the as they do things throughout the community, and we want you to give liberally. The baskets out in the foyer as you're leaving, please remember to go out there and drop your offering in. And we appreciate our youth department and all that they do. You can either take a minute and get it ready, or you can, you know, like I said, just drop it in after service if you didn't have a chance to beforehand. And you said, you might be here tonight and say, Pastor Keith, I don't have anything to give. Listen, we're not asking you for anything except your obedience to the Spirit of God. Amen? I want you to sing this chorus one more time. And I want you to really think about what you're singing. I want you to think about the power of God that we have literally at our fingertips. How many are thankful for what God wants to do, what He can do, and what He wants to do in your life? Amen? You believe He wants to move in your life? You believe that He will move in your life? Come on, let's give Him praise. But tonight, before we go any further, we got to make sure that His presence is here. And it says that He inhabits the praises of His people. Would you just lift your hands tonight as we worship Him and sing it, of course, one more time. Holy Spirit. Come on up here. Come on. Come on. Montana, Michelle, y'all come on, do this with me. Y'all know this. Where's she at? There she comes. This is a song that they've done, you know, for a long time. And I'm sitting over there and I'm thinking, we're just going to do a little bit of battle first. You know, anytime anything important happens, you got to battle. You either battle things out in a spiritual realm, in an emotional realm, in a physical realm. You know, you do battle, right? Y'all ready? Will you give it? Will you give it? Hit it. Come on.
Y'all get up, sir.
Soul.
So as you know, we have it's been going through some crazy wild stuff in our country lately. And I saw somebody had put something on social media that said, you know, I can't wait to get to hug again, or I can't wait to get to shake hands again, or I can't wait to go visit somebody again. And when I read that, the Spirit of the Lord immediately spoke to me, and it was like, Christy, he put a 50-pound weight on my shoulders, and he said, what is stopping you? What is stopping you? I said, well, God, you know, it's this and it's that. He said, no, it ain't. No, it ain't. I said, well, I don't understand. He said, it's words written on a phone screen. It's words written on a computer screen. It's words somebody said in a video somewhere. That it's words is all that it took to get people to give up territory. I'll tell you what, I'm sick and tired of the devil messing with me. I'm sick and tired. How many of you are sick and tired of being fed up? I hear people say, I'm fed up. How fed up are we? How fed up are we? That's what I want to ask you. You said, well, Pastor Kid, you know, you got to use wisdom. I am using wisdom. I'm using the wisdom of the Lord. Amen? That's what I'm using. People might say, well, you know, you're being reckless. No, I'm not. I'm a healthcare provider. I know what all the statistics say. I know how to look up CDC facts as much as anybody else, and World Health Organization, and listen to this one and listen to that one. I know how to listen to that, but I also know how to listen to thus saith the Lord God. Right. I know what the Bible says, and I shared with you guys a couple of weeks ago a passage of Scripture, and I said, God has been dealing with me about this, and I don't know where it's going. I don't know, but it has been ringing and ringing and ringing in my ears. And that is the Scripture in the book of James, chapter 5. It's our main passage for tonight. And it says in verse 13, is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Let him pray. It's saying, bring your petitions before the Lord over and over and over and over through Scripture. It says, if you got a need, cast that care upon the Lord, because he cares about you. Amen. Listen, the devil ain't never cared about you. The world don't care about you. People are going to say, well, Pastor Keith, if you preach like this, you're not going to be very popular. I didn't go into ministry to be popular. I went into ministry to preach the truth, because it's the truth that makes people free. Amen? And we talk about slavery and we talk about racism. There are a lot of people that are in slavery and in bondage to sin and lies and deception today. People that say that they love the Lord, and they're in bondage to fear. They're afraid to walk out of their house. They're afraid to turn around. They're afraid to love one another. They're afraid to even talk to one another. They don't know which way to turn. And we say all the time, I'm going to tell you, Christian people will quote that scripture, for God's not given me a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. But then we'll turn right around and we'll say, we got to use wisdom. And that wisdom, a lot of times, not all the time, but a lot of times, is nothing. It is driven by a spirit of fear. Listen, I got news for you. If you say you're a Christian, the world already don't like you. It don't matter how you preach. So you can sit back and you can do nothing. And you can allow the world to walk all over you. Sister Andre, they ain't going to like you no better. They're just going to say you're weak. Come on. They're just going to say you're weak. You know what I say? When I am weak, he is strong. In my weakness, his strength is made perfect. So what are we talking about here tonight? It goes on and it says that if anyone among you that's cheerful, it says, let him sing songs. The Bible says that the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. And it says that the joy of the Lord is our strength. So I say, if you're cheerful right now, go ahead and sing your song, honey. Sing it loud and sing it proud that God is able and God is good and God is faithful.
faithful to all generations. So you sing your song because somebody needs to hear some good news tonight. There's so much bad news going around. There's enough bad news out there to drown a whole city. Come on, somebody needs to turn loose the breath of God. But it doesn't stop there. It goes on and it says that if there's any among you sick, it says, let him call for the elders of the church. And it says, and let them pray over him. Let them pray over him. You know what else it says? It says, and let them anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And it says, and the prayer of faith will save the sick. And it says, and the Lord shall raise him up. And it even goes on and says that his sins will be forgiven. And that passage has haunted me ever since all of this mess started. You hear me? It has haunted me. We talk about being hungry for God. We talk about being hungry for one another. Then we need to put some effort into what our words are speaking. Because I'm telling you, words can do a lot of damage. Those words on your phone screen have driven the majority of churches to separate and divide. They've driven people to get comfortable. I heard a minister today say that you know, online services, while it's reached a lot of people, it has. But I also want to tell you, and I warned you about this when we started all this mess. I warned you specifically that it would be extremely difficult for some folks to get back in the house of the Lord because you would get comfortable. And I was listening to this coming home, and this minister said, we got to where we were trying to minister to people in their comfort place, in their pajamas. You know what? We started letting down our standards before COVID-19 and made the sanctuary of God about like a coffee club. And that was a precursor to this. There's a sign out there that says, don't bring your food and drink in here. And it's out there for a reason, because you are standing on holy ground. People said, well, it's not the building that's the church. You're exactly right. It's not. But the Bible said, go into the highways and the hedges and compel them to come in his house. His house matters. His house matters. Is this what I'm preaching about tonight? No. This is just all free. This is my offering to you. So that James chapter 5, which has been ringing in my ears, it's been ringing in my head. He said these words on people's phones, these alerts that come up, these, it's just, you know, all this fear that's being unleashed on people. He said, it's just words on a screen, and that has stolen the ability for people to live. That song we just sang, how many years have our young people been doing that song? I'm waging war, Sister Trina. I'm waging war. When Lincoln blew the shofar, blow it again. Come on, blow it hard. Come on, blow it. Blow it. Come on. It's a call to worship. It's a call to war. It's easy to do that when you're not in battle. You hear me? It's easy to stand up and shout glory, hallelujah. It's easy to run over here and grab a flag or something and run around and wave that flag and wave that banner. Oh, that's easy. It's easy to do that. Yeah. Praise God. Praise God. Life is great. I've got a bunch of money in my bank account. Nobody in my family's sick. I can come and go as I want to go. The problem is people go more than they come.
Amen. That's right.
When things are good. You say, well, don't be trying to make people feel bad. No, what I'm trying to do is make people feel good. Because I'm going to tell you, when you're walking in the light, when you're walking in truth, you have less anxiety, less depression. Come on. You have less stress. You have less cares and worries that your whenever you have less stress and less anxiety and less depression, you are going to have better health in your physical body. Remember, I'm a healthcare provider. I know what I'm talking about. You know what one of the leading causes of death? Stress. Do you hear me? I'm preaching truth to somebody tonight. And I kept hearing that verse, James 5, over and over. And I thought, God, something don't feel right. I was preaching Sunday. Something just don't taste right to me. Whether it's cancer or whether it's cold, I want you to know there's more stuff that will kill you these days. There are other things besides COVID-19 that will kill you. Do you hear me? Diabetes, high blood pressure, all these things, cancer, it'll kill you unless the Lord heals you. We all face some sort of sickness at some point in time. I shared with you just the other day that the Lord had touched my body Saturday night. I wasn't feeling the best. I knew I had to preach. I knew it was an attack of the enemy. I want to ask you right now, how many of you, either you or someone in your family, today, the enemy came against you physically to try to keep you out of the house of the Lord tonight? Would you raise your hand? That's over half of you. Now I want you to give God a hand clap of praise. I'm going to have to get comfortable here, y'all. I'm about to burn and slam up. Why did I get you to give God a hand clap of praise? Huh? Why did I get you to give God a hand clap of praise whenever you acknowledged that physical ailments had tried to come against you or someone in your family? Because what you may not have realized is that sickness must be present for healing to take place. Do you hear me? Let me ask you this. If your house or your car was paid off, if your mortgage was paid in full, would you send them extra payments? No. That sounds silly, doesn't it? There's no need, right? Well, if there's no sickness, then there's no need for healing. So those of you that raised your hand, I want you to know that today, God trusted you to walk it out. He trusted you to walk it out. Because tonight, He needed somebody that He could move through. So what are you talking about? When you woke up this morning and your arm was hurt, He needed you to walk it out. I believe that your hip was hurt. He needed you to walk it out. Your stomach was hurting. Your this was hurting. Your that was hurting. You didn't feel it. Didn't feel that. He needs you to walk it out. He needs you to press through. Because somewhere down the road, there's going to be somebody that comes into your path. And you're going to be able to testify the goodness of God and the glory of God because He touched your body here tonight. And I believe that's what He's going to do. So when the words on this little screen of this electronic device can have that much power, how much more power should the words on the pages of this book have? Come on, if we're believers, how much more power should these words have? I'm sick and tired of the devil stealing from me. I'm sick and tired of watching him steal people's joy, people's peace, and people's health. Come on! A couple of years ago, I don't know if some of you remember it or not, but a couple of years ago, we began to pray against every spirit of infirmity that would try to hit the doors of this building. Do you remember that? Psalms 91, Brother Barry, that actually ain't in my notes. Go figure, Brother Barry told me I put the whole Bible in my notes tonight. And I ain't even got to them yet. In Psalms 91, it says, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." And it goes on and on and on and on and on. And it talks about a covering where no harm will come nigh thy tent. That means no harm will come even near your house. Your house. And we as believers, nationwide, believers have just sat down and we've sat back and we've said, "Enemy, just come in and take and pillage and plunder and do whatever you want." Let me tell you something. Let me put it into perspective for you. If you, as a born-again believer, were to begin to go out into the streets and into the communities and begin to terrorize men and women and children, if you were to go and to begin burning buildings and throwing blocks and bricks through windows, do you think that because you say you're a Christian that anybody would think that it was okay? No. So why do we sit back and let the enemy do that to the body of Christ? Why? If our camels are coming in, what are we doing when the enemy sends his devils to go and cause a stampede in the other direction? And that's exactly what the church has done. The church world. We've sat back and we've allowed the enemy to pillage and plunder and steal our joy and steal our victory and steal our shout. Come on. The Bible says that when we're sick, we can come boldly to the throne of God. Boldly means that you have the understanding, you have the wisdom, you have the knowledge that you know you are in the right. You are in the right. If you're in a store somewhere, Sister Doris, if you and Brooke were in the store, she wouldn't walk up to a stranger and say, "Hey, would you buy me this top? Would you buy me this candy bar? Would you buy me this? Would you buy me that?" Why? Why would she not do that, church? Because that would be weird. Because she wouldn't have that authority. But she'd have no problem coming to you and asking you to do it. Because she knows that she is yours. She knows that you care for her. But the church, along the way, as a whole, has forgotten that He cares for you. Y'all ought to be tearing this place apart right now. Are you just taking it in? As long as you're here with me. I'm going to go as quickly as I can. I've got plenty of time. So I want you to know that we need to approach the Lord in the name of Jesus with faith and expectancy, believing that He still heals the sick, He still sets the captive free, He still has and exercises dominion over the powers of darkness and every devil in hell. Come on, somebody. We know that He roars over us, but I'm going to tell you what. It's time that the church stand back up and roar herself. Amen? Amen? I'm tired. I'm sick and tired of the devil tormenting us. I hear people that don't know the Lord talking about, "Oh Lord, what's going to happen? I don't know what's going on." I hear people that claim to know Jesus and they have more doom and gloom come out of their mouth. My God. You know what doubt and unbelief is? It's a sin. You know what doing something that's contrary to the Word of God is, that's witchcraft. You hear me? It's witchcraft. I just preached Sunday about he that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it's sin. We just preached Sunday about applying the Word. Apply the Word that we hear. Jesus once told a woman in Matthew 9, verse 22, and when I call these scriptures out, I'm not going to read them all because it would take us all night. She risked everything just to touch him. You know why she touched him? To call attention, to call his attention to her purpose, to her need. It's time that some people wake up and be willing to risk everything to touch him, to call God's attention to your purpose, what's going on in your life. Amen? God heals emotionally. Sometimes emotional wounds can be deeper and more painful than even physical injuries. Amen? But I want you to know there's healing. The absence of parental love a lot of times will cause emotional insecurities. That pain of rejection and betrayal, it'll put us into rituals, ritualistic behavior, and we'll fall into habits and we'll keep living the same mistakes over and over and over and over and over and over and over. We'll keep going back to that comfortable sin rather than push into Him. We go back to that place where the enemy says, this is your pathway for peace. He does not love you. The devil hates you. If the path that you are on is not leading you to life, an abundant life, then it's of the devil. And I want to tell you something, living in fear, being depressed all the time, and being anxious all the time, being depressed all the time, feeling like you want to kill yourself, and you don't care about anything, you don't care about anybody, you don't trust God anymore, you don't believe Him. I'm going to tell you, that's not of God. God never designed us to experience that kind of grief and sorrow. We were made to love Him and to love people. All people. But in the midst of everything that's going on, the enemy has tried to cause us to hate one another. I decree and I declare and I proclaim that I love the Lord and I love people. I love all people. It doesn't matter to me where you've been. It doesn't matter to me how low you have been or what you have done. I believe with every fiber of my being that my surrender to Him. He is our hope. Amen. I want you to know tonight that God heals spiritually as well, church. Psalms 147:3. There's healing that takes place. It tells us that He heals the brokenhearted and He binds up their wounds. Hebrews 4, verses 15 and 16. Says that we have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but one who has been tempted in all things as we are, yet without sin. It says, therefore, let us draw near with confidence to the throne of grace, so that we may receive mercy and find grace and help in our time of need. There's somebody here tonight. You need to know what grace is. You need to just lay down and feel His mercy. All of us in some way are in need. Spiritual healing comes for folks that have been raised in cults or who have even been raised in the church world where there's a lot of legalism, a lot of hypocrisy, a lot of judgment, and they've never known the love of God, and they've never known the peace of God, where there's a lot of rules and regulations, but there's no relationship. There's no intimacy with the Father. I was speaking to someone once, and they were telling me about a ritualistic thing that their mother would do every year, and it completely warped this person's view of all Christians. And they profess today to be an atheist, a non-believer. They need spiritual healing. They need somebody, as we were preaching Sunday, to reflect the Father to them, that they see Jesus. The view of Christ that other people see cannot be tainted by a poor representation from the body of Christ. Amen. Psalms 139, I believe it is, verse 23 and 24. Became a personal prayer to be healed spiritually. And it can be yours. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. Do you understand what we're going through in the days that we're living now are trying us? It is proving us. Do you hear me? Either we are running to Him or we are running from Him. And this is not a new message that I'm preaching. I've been preaching this the whole time I've been ministering. Try me, O God, and see. And see if there be any wicked way in me. And lead me in the way everlasting. I want you to know that God heals our past wounds. He heals those wounds that we just can't seem to overcome in ourselves. The hurt, the unforgiveness. He'll heal you. He will miraculously heal you. And you will experience freedom. And you will experience liberty that you never knew was possible. Amen. That offense that the enemy tries to get you to feel. How many of you have ever had the enemy try to get you to be offended or hurt at someone and hold on to that? Anybody? Should be all of us probably at some time. I want you to know He can heal you of that offense. Listen. One problem that a lot of folks have is forgiving themselves. It may not be forgiving other people, but forgiving themselves. But I want to point something out to you. If God is able and willing to forgive you, then you should be able to forgive yourself. And He said He would. He said He would. The Bible says, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature, and old things are passed away, and all things have become new. If you know Jesus as your personal Savior, or once you ask the Lord to come into your heart, those old things have passed away. All the mistakes you made, it's all gone. The Bible tells us in Psalms 103, I think it's verse 12, that as far as the east is from the west, so far hath He removed our transgressions or our sins from us. Do you understand what great news this is? I could go around the room, and if you would be honest and tell the worst thing that you feel like you have ever done, which I know nobody's going to do it. I know you're not. But if you did, I want you to know that if you truly repented, that God would remove that from you as far as the east is from the west. Because that's how He moves. I want you to know that He heals minds and He heals hearts. Romans 12:2 tells us to not be conformed to this world, but to be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and what is the perfect will of God. You can prove it when you renew your mind. When you refuse to live like the world, when you refuse to live like a lost person and live like a believer, you can prove God's word. He'll prove it to you because He'll prove it through you. We have to allow God to renew our mind, and He does that with His word. 1 Corinthians 12, verses 8, 9, 10, 11. Talks about the gifts. It says, for one is given by the Spirit of word, the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. Verse 9, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But all these work that one and the self-same Spirit dividing to every man severally as he will. The gifts of the Spirit. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 1, follow after charity, but desire spiritual gifts. It's saying, follow after love. Man, let the love of God lead you and guide you, but desire the spiritual gifts. I want you to know that healings and miracles, that's a gift. And he says, desire that. Want it. Want it. If your heart has been broken, you should want to be healed. Do you hear me? If you are feeling broken, whoever you are, you should want to be healed. If you're carrying around offense, you should want to be healed from that. If you are tormented because of something spiritual that happened to you once upon a time, somebody really disappointed you or whatever, and you just lost faith in the church, and you lost faith in Christianity, and you lost faith in God, you should want to be healed from that. It says to desire the gifts. Besides honoring God and glorifying Jesus, I want you to know tonight, church, that healing is the common good for the church. 1 Corinthians 12:7. It tells us, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit everybody. If God blesses Sister Peggy and heals her, guess what? It benefits us all. Because when she begins to testify, what's the Bible say? We're made overcomers by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. When somebody gets saved, I told you just this past Sunday, I think I told you Sunday night that Turkey Cove had somebody saved Sunday morning. They don't go to our church. I don't know who it was, but I know Brother David and I know Sister Margie. I said, praise God, they had somebody saved. And then they had another one say, Sunday night, praise God.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They're free will Baptist, y'all, Church of God. Yeah, but we're the body of Christ. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Right.
Oh, come on. That is weak. We are the body. We. Us and Bethel Baptist, we're the body of Christ. Us in Cherry Springs, we're the body of Christ. Us in the Old Fort Church of God, we're the body of Christ. Us in Grace Community, we're the body of Christ. Us in Greenleaf Baptist, told you Sunday, the church, the body of Christ, is the most powerful group of people on the face of the earth. And the enemy knows that. The only one that doesn't know it is the church. Jesus healed while proclaiming the gospel, while preaching. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 23, it says, "And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people." And it goes on. It says in Romans 5, 17, "For if by one man's offense death reigned, by one, much more than which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ." And in chapter 8, verse 20, "For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope." In verse 21, "Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God." I want you to know that he wants to bring healing to you. He wants to set you free. He wants you to be liberated. In Psalms 103, it says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits." Look at this, church. Look at this. Look at this passage. Hear me, young people. You young ladies, you listen to me. Bless the Lord with everything in you, and don't forget all of his benefits. Y'all hear that? But whenever we sit back and we allow the enemy to have his way, guess what we're doing? We're forgetting every benefit that God has given us. Sister Angie, all those years that he has poured his spirit into us, when we allow the enemy to come in and say, "Here, I'll take that, and I'll take that, and I'll take that." It's just like saying, "God, right here, guys, bless the Lord. Oh, I'm going to hear you go, oh." Come on. Do it like groan from your gut. Like grit your teeth kind of groan. Oh. My soul. You know, when you go to pray and you go into intercession, the Bible talks praying with groanings which cannot be uttered, because it comes from the very depths of your soul. When Hannah was praying for a child, it said she poured her soul out before the Lord because she wanted that child more than anything. Tanner, we cannot afford to forget his benefits. Not one of them. Not one. It's not okay to give up an inch. The Bible says give no place to the devil. No place. Not an inch. Because if you give him an inch, he'll take a... Bless the Lord. Bless him. You gotta bless him. Bless him. Bless him. Oh, so. It's painful. When a woman gives birth, what kind of sound does she make? Come on. Depends on if she can get a hold of her husband's throat. But you hear, oh! It's called travail. Forget not his benefits. Verse 3. Who forgiveth all thine iniquities? Who healeth all? Who healeth who healeth, who healeth, who healeth. All the men say it. All the ladies say it. All the church say it. All the men say it. All the women. All the young people. All the older people. All the church. He healeth thy diseases. Who redeemeth thy life from destruction. Do you understand? This passage is saying, he turns your car around. He's driving. He's driving. He's in control. That's good news, church. Listen. Listen to me. We want to give up control so easily to the enemy. I want to see somebody give God control. How about it? And it says, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies. Hallelujah. Give him praise tonight. Verse 5. Who satisfieth thy mouth with good things. Somebody say good things. Good. Say it again. Good. Shout it. Good. Shout it louder. Good. Come on. So that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. Brother Dale, come here. Come here. Listen to me. The enemy tried to kill, steal, and destroy him. Come up here. And those of you that knew Brother Dale before and that know him today, you know what the enemy tried to do to him. I went to the hospital with him over and over and over when he was near death. And because he was unable to forgive himself, he just wouldn't surrender at that time. But when he did, I want you to know that God turned his car around and he began to satisfy his soul with good things and renewed his youth like the eagles. Come on, and God returned 20 years to his life. Come on. And the devil hated it so much that he tried to come back and he tried to kill and he tried to steal and destroy him again. Come on. Come on. But he didn't do it. Because our God is able. And our God is willing. Look, come on. You know what you're looking at, church? This is living proof. Our God is on the move. There's nothing that he won't do. Let your faith rise up, somebody. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, buddy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is good. Amen. I want you to know tonight that these passages we just read, God's promise to an obedient Israel. In many ways, their physical health was directly connected to their obedience. Do you hear what I'm saying to you? The Bible says the wages of sin is death. If you're going to run around and live the life of an alcoholic, it's going to destroy your body. If you're going to run around and you're going to overeat all the time, you're going to have blood pressure stuff going on. You're going to have diabetes. It's just going to happen. You say, well, now don't talk about eating. Yes, I can. Yes, I will. I got to wrestle with that too now. You go out here driving fast as you can everywhere you go. We were on our way to church and some numbskull comes flying around the road. I mean, Sister Darlene, both, oh God. They keep driving like that, they'll be like whoever. I don't know what happened in Old Fork. Somebody had a horrible crash right there at the McDonald's and the interstate bridge. They had EMS and people sitting out on the grass and cars sitting around everywhere. You go driving too fast, and sooner or later it's going to catch up with you. Living life in the fast lane. I'm not saying that's what happened to those folks. Don't misunderstand me. But sooner or later, you'll find a curve that's just a little too sharp. Or a stop sign that popped up out of nowhere. You won't see them and they won't see you. You can read the newspaper just about every week where there's been some kind of motor vehicle accident. And somebody's life was taken, or somebody was permanently crippled or something. The wages of sin is death. When we're obedient to God, we said this in the beginning, we're at peace with Him. Exodus 15:26. And he said, if you diligently heed the voice of the Lord your God and do what's right in his sight, give ear to his commandments and keep all of his statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you which I have brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you.
Hallelujah.
Do you see that, church? People say, well, that's the Old Testament. That was for the children of Israel. That wasn't for us. Listen, the whole Bible's for the people of God.
Amen.
If that's who you are, if you ain't in the Lord, it ain't for you. Come on. If you don't know Jesus, if you don't know the Lord, these promises and these blessings don't apply to you. You can moan all day. But you won't get none. Psalms 34:19 says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them. Delivers him out of? Out of them. Out of them. Somebody's got to get it. Out of them. We'll keep doing this all night till you act like you actually believe it, because that's what you're here for. Out of them. Out of them. You about to get there. Jerusalem was filled with destruction and death. We preached about it Sunday a little bit. And to this city, God promised to bring health and healing, to reveal to them the abundance of peace and truth. How many of you know that as a nation, we need the abundance of peace and we need some truth for a change? Come on. Come on. How many of you are sick and tired of not knowing whether to believe this one over here or this one over here? This side over here or this side over here? I'll tell you right now, with absolute confidence, you can believe this side right here. You can take it to the bank and he won't never run out of change. Jeremiah 33:6 says, behold, I will bring in health and healing. I will heal them and reveal to them the abundance of peace and truth. Mark 16, verse 17. And these signs shall follow them that believe in my name. Shall they cast out devils? Shall they speak with new tongues? Verse 18. They shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. And they shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they
shall.
They lay hands on the sick, and they
shall.
They'll lay hands on the sick, and they
shall.
They'll run them all off and tell them to stay at home. And if you're sick, and if you got cancer, and if you got diabetes, you stay at your house. That ain't what it says. It says they'll lay hands on them, and they
shall.
They shall recover. They shall recover. Listen, I know God has a plan for me. I know God has a plan for me. I know God has a plan for you. Because you are His people and you are called according to His purposes and you love Him. Come on. So He has a hope and a future for you. And I don't care what it looks like. I don't care what it sounds like. I don't care what kind of dogs are barking. Come on! Luke 4. Verse 40. And when the sun was setting, all they that had any sick and diverse diseases, they brought them unto him. And he laid his hands on every. He laid his hands on. He laid his hands on every one of them. And healed them. And who would not want this? Come on. Go ahead, Deb, just take what you want. The kitchen sink's over there. Get that too. I'm going to be socially correct, and I'm going to sit back and not say nothing, and I'm going to sit back and not do nothing. And but what I ain't realizing is that when the devil gets through, I won't be nothing neither. And I'm going to tell you what, he takes the broken things and he makes them beautiful and he calls them his. You hear me? And that's who we are. He knows my name. Isaiah 53. I don't know about y'all, but it is all over me tonight. It says, surely He has borne our griefs and He's carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem Him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Glory to God. He was wounded for our transgressions. And He was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace was upon Him. And by His stripes we are healed. We are healed. We are healed. Going back to our original scripture tonight. Brother Jake and you, Sister Darlene, Sister Christy, Sister Shelby, Tanner, Trina, y'all come back up here. James 5, if any among you afflicted, let him pray. If you're afflicted with something, the enemy's come against you, pray. Cast your cares upon him. I had a friend who prayed one time and he said something and I never forgot it. And it said, we place these things at the foot of the cross where they have to give account of themselves to the name and the blood of Jesus. When he says cast something, you ever been fishing? You ever been fishing? How you cast it? Cast your line. Show me how to cast it. You don't just drop it in the water out there at you, do you? You got to throw it out there. And when you throw it out there, if something's fragile and you throw it out there, what happens to it? It breaks. It shatters into a million pieces. And you know why that's important? Because then we can't run back and pick up that fragile thing and try to use it again. And that's what we do. Cast your cares upon Him. Because He cares for you. So if there's anybody here and you're afflicted with something, the enemy's just, man, he's just riding you. He's riding you hard. Pray. Just pray. And let him speak to your heart. Let him say, hey, you know what? I have not forgotten you. I know every hair on your head. I know every breath that you take. I know every step that you take. I know every concern that you have. I see every tear that you shed. I heard you every time you prayed. I heard you. And because things didn't work out the way that you asked, that doesn't mean I didn't hear you, because I did. Pray. And it says, if there be any among you that are married, then sing your song. It's hard to get everybody at the same place at the same time. You can have a household of people. You can say, what do you want for dinner? Where do y'all want to go eat? And you'll have 15 different ideas. And then you'll have something that I don't care. But then when you go somewhere, it's like, I didn't want this. Can you imagine the Father? If there's somebody here that's married, and then things are good where you are, and sing your songs, yes. Because you may be the one that gets the Father's attention, that gets Him to come and inhabit the house where we are. Because there might be somebody that's afflicted that they can't get Him here like you can. But your song and that anointing that runs through you, it'll get in here, because He promised that He would show up. But then, for those tonight that are sick, there be any sick among them that I'm calling the elders of the church. He said, well, who are the elders? I'm going to tell you who the elders are. The elders are those who understand that God is faithful and that His word is true and He'll do what He said He would. That's the elders. The ones that know that His word is truth, and that believe Him, and that have that faith that will rise up in them. Look, you don't have to be some famous somebody. You just got to be you. And you just got to trust Him. So tonight, I'm going to, as they sing this song, I've been feeling this, and I'm just going to be obedient. I hope this message has been an encouragement to somebody out there in Facebook land. Listen, don't you think for one second that I'm trying to guilt trip nobody, but you better know for sure that I could not and I would not leave here without trying to set somebody free, because I've seen too many people walking around in spiritual captivity for far too long. We've sat back for months now and allowed the enemy to keep us tied down and bound up. Come on, somebody. It's time for the church to rise up. Rise up. Rise up. Hallelujah. If you're here tonight and there's something physical going on in your body, I want you to come and stand here across the front. Get up out of your seat. You want God to touch you. I believe He will supernaturally manifest here tonight. The Bible says that if we will lay hands on the sick and anoint them, that it will save the sick and that He will raise them up. You believe God's word? Have you been encouraged by it tonight? I need some people that believe to come back here. Come up here and you put your hands, and you have one on here, one here, one here, one here. Yeah, like you can be on two. If you're comfortable doing that, just come up here, lay your hands on a couple. If there's anybody else here tonight, maybe you're in that afflicted class and you just don't know what's going on, or maybe you got some other stuff going on. You need to spend some time in the Lord. I want you to come over here and find you a place in the altar. And I want you to come and just bow down. Maybe you're here tonight and you say, Pastor Keith, man, this sounds really good. And this has really been an encouragement to me. But I'm not even sure where I stand in the Lord. If that's you tonight, I want you to come up here and find your place in the altar. And I want you to pray. And you just raise your hand to me, let me know. I'm going to come and pray with you. I'll answer any questions you have, any doubts that you might have. I'm telling you, we'll pray. I'm going to bind up the enemy. And we'll stand with you. And we'll walk with you. And we will surround you. And we will cover you. Amen.
Somebody catch it, don't let nobody get to you.
We're just going to pray. Now listen, I need you young people. Y'all preach your names up real good. We'll sing. Y'all young people, listen to me. Listen to me, Andrew. You guys, there is something about the faith of a child that will move mountains. So I need you guys, honestly, I need you to help me out with this, okay? Right where you are, as we're praying for all these folks, I need you to stretch your hand out toward them. And the only thing he had to do is just say, God, I agree with my pastor, and I pray for all of these people. I pray for all of them. That's all I need you to do, just stretch your hand out toward them. And just as we're praying, when we start praying here in a minute, I need you guys to just say, God, we trust you. Because I'm going to tell you something. A child, Molly, yeah, a child will believe. You hear me? I need y'all to pray. Lucan, I need you to sound the war call. Church, I need y'all to, you can stand, if you would stand where you are, and y'all stretch out your hands this way as we pray, and y'all sing. Come on, sing.
Yeah.
It rises up right now. Anybody up here tonight that you need to heal in your body of anything, and you feel like that God touched you, and you just want to testify that right here, right now.
I've been worried, I guess it's a lot of you know about the granddaughter. And the devil's been fighting me, I mean, any way he could. Thoughts, mainly. And I said, no, I can't do this. COVID about killed me. And I said, I can't keep going with this. And I thought to read the Bible. And I started reading Exodus the other night. I couldn't sleep, so I got up and got to read Exodus. And today, I just got to need to hear something about the Lord. So I turned on a YouTube thing. And I started reading out Exodus 2. And then I turned over to another one, and they was talking about how God and the Spirit will take you through anything in this world that you can ever come across. All you got to do is believe it. And I'm like, the devil is robbing me. He's taking my mind. Right there, I can't believe I've let him come in. He's took territory in my mind. Right there, just one way. I said, I can't do it anymore. I can't live like this. So I got to praying, and I just started worshiping the Lord. And I said, God, I know without a shadow of a doubt that you are in control. You've got this world, you've got Israel. They might be over there getting ready to bomb them day after tomorrow for all we know. But you know what? It don't matter. That's only a third of the angels that fell from heaven. God's still got two-thirds of them there. Guess who's going to win this battle? So I'm confident, and I know without a shadow of doubt that whatever comes out of this will come out for God's will and His purpose. And He's seen me through way many things. Y'all just don't have a clue what else God's seen me through. Brother Dale, I can reminisce with you on that a lot at the drinking thing. COVID almost got me. No, we got through COVID. Then this happened. The devil is on the loose. But I got living proof. Thank you, Jesus.
Since the devil's on the loose, actually, the Bible says in Matthew 18 that whatever you bind on earth, it's talking about you. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in the heavens, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loose in the heavens. So if we don't want the devil to be loose, somebody better start binding him up. Somebody speak to it in the name of Jesus. We come in agreement. The Bible says where two or three should agree is touching any, that it shall be done. And so we right now begin to decree and declare right here in the name of Jesus, we bind every spirit of darkness. We come against you in the name of Jesus, and we agree according to the word of God. God, not only is your word true for our healing and for our health and for our salvation and our redemption and our restoration, but also for our peace of mind and knowing, God, that we can still move and operate in your spirit, that we can be a light to a world that's bound up in darkness. We break every chain in the name of Jesus. Come on, break every chain in Jesus' name. And we bind up every spirit of darkness and every lie of the devil. And we pray against every spirit of witchcraft and every spirit of deception and every spirit of distraction and every spirit that would try to steal, kill, or destroy anything that God has given to His people. We stand up in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Anybody else? Come on.
And I praise God every day. And I stand up here and I declare my healing in
Jesus' name. And I declare blessings over this church.
Vision, and it was about my head was up here, but in my vision I was hooked up to everything. My head was down at the foot of the bed, and I kept And it was like death, and there was a death grip on me. So I kept walking through that, the valley of death. I kept walking through that. And then it was about, when I wrestled and wrestled with it, then I said, I walked out into the sunshine. I said, okay, Lord, I choose to live. He said, I'm not through with you yet. And I said, okay, I choose to live. And so I just got up then and started going, don't do this, don't do that. You know, they'll tell you all this stuff. No, I don't take that. You know, if you're going to walk by faith, it don't mean be foolish, but if you're going to walk by faith, what does the Word say? And that's what I go by. And I'm doing things that they said I could not do. So it's impossible. But I'm doing it.
Praise the Lord. All right. Guys, if you enjoyed being here tonight, are you glad you came to the house of the Lord? Do you feel better than you did when you came? You know, the Bible, we sing that song, you know, I don't want to leave here like I came in Jesus' name. Amen. So I want you to hold your head up, and tomorrow when you go back out into your day, your world, I want people to see a change in you. Brother Barry, as I said, he was teasing me. He said, you put the whole Bible in here for tonight. I said, well, I ain't going to read it all. But listen, that word, every scripture we read, do you realize what that was doing? That was a breath from God going into your spirit. That was a breath of God. I'd stand up here and talk all night. That ain't going to do you no good. But the scripture is living word.
Amen.
And that's just like a breath from God going into you. Father, we ask you one final time tonight just to reach your hand down and touch every person here, regardless of how young or how old we are. And I pray, Father God, a blessing and a covering over each one. Those that could not be here tonight, God, those that are on vacation, those that are trying to be safe at home, those maybe that are working that couldn't get here, God, whatever the reason, we pray a covering over them. Those that have watched us tonight on Facebook, if anybody's out there, we pray for them, God, those that are part of our e-family. And we just ask that you let us rest underneath your wings, and that you cover us with your feathers until, God, it is time for us to rise up like eagles. Hallelujah. And God, that you would give us the strength to stand and to soar above every storm cloud that the forces of darkness try to bring against us. God, we decree and we declare and we proclaim your word is true, and we stand on your promises in the name of Jesus. We trust you, God, in every situation, in every circumstance, and let your word spill out of our mouths. God, every time we're even tempted throughout this week to say something negative, God, let your word come alive and let it just spring out of us. Let it just spill out of us. Let it be overflow. We thank you, Father, for everything that you have done, for everything that you're doing, and everything you're going to do. In Jesus' name we pray, and the church shouted,
Amen.
Amen.